Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy. Today, Senator Adriano Espaillat is here to talk about what's happening in the New York State Senate. How are you, Senator?
Hi, Julia. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you for being here. So we have a lot to talk about today, housing, health care. You've been concerned about the conditions and services at New York Presbyterian's emergency room. What led you to this investigation that you've been doing?
Well, first, I've got lots of complaints from constituents about the wait time in the emergency rooms, not just at the main campus on 168th Street, but at the Allen Pavilion and the Children's Hospital, which has an emergency room, a state-of-the-art emergency room recently built to the cost of $50 million. But when people go there, when children go there, when people go to the main campus on 168th Street or the Allen Pavilion, they have to wait long hours, sometimes 8, 12, 15 hours before they're actually taken care of. So this led me to put together a public hearing where many people showed up, patients, doctors, nurses, health advocates, community folks, and they testified about the conditions of the emergency room in New York Presbyterian Hospital. And they testify as to the long waits. We were privy to some information, data from the federal government that stated that the wait time in the emergency room at New York Presbyterian Hospital was twice as long as any other hospital, similar hospital across the country and the city. And that waiting to get a bed will take twice as long in New York Presbyterian Hospital as a similar hospital across the city, state, and nation. So this is a chronic problem, and we know that they're looking to build a brand new facility by 2017, but I feel that the community should not be held to these standards for the next 2 years, and that the facility itself is not the issue. It's a staffing issue and other types of issues that must be resolved.
So you put out a report, right?
That's correct. We put out a report asking for many changes, and I've introduced legislation that is looking to ask not only New York Presbyterian, but all hospitals across the state to have a clock, a wait time clock for emergency room services in their website, in front of the emergency room, in front of the hospitals. So patients, when they go there, they know how long they will have to wait, and they're not subject to the hardship, to the anxiety, if you may, of waiting, you know, for hours and hours and hours.
Yeah, that's a good idea. So what is the travel time like to get to another hospital if they need to?
Well, many people, 5% of the folks that go to the emergency room are opting to leave the emergency room without any services whatsoever because of the long wait time. And they go into other hospitals in Westchester County, in Yonkers and in Westchester County, and even in the Bronx. They go into some hospitals where they feel that the emergency room service is much better than New York Presbyterian. And so we have this very prestigious institution in New York Presbyterian Hospital, which touts its academic, its research capability. But on the other hand, you have two levels of service, one for the very rich, affluent patient that either pays cash or has private insurance, and a very sort of like second-class type of treatment for those patients that have Medicaid and Medicare. So we wanna highlight the fact that there's a tale of two hospitals, one for the very rich with a very fine facility for the emergency room services for people that come in from across the world. There's a campaign, PR campaign, that the hospital put out, which says amazing things happen in New York Presbyterian hospitals. And they do, for very rich people and people with private insurance, but not for the poor that rely on Medicaid and Medicare.
That's unfortunate. So you have a lot of recommendations.
Yes.
What are you going to do to make sure these are acted upon?
Well, we are putting together a task force of community folks. So this is not just about the senator's office. This is really about the community. So nurses that are engaged right now in the middle of a contract fight with the hospitals that feel that 300 of which have filed complaint orders, meaning that when they take care of patients, too many patients, they sign a document that says, we're not liable for the safety of this patient, the well-being of this patient, because we have too many of them. And so 300 times that has occurred or more in the emergency room at New York Presbyterian. The nurses are going to be part of that task force. Local doctors that know firsthand what is the condition of their patients when they go to the emergency room. How long do they have to wait? Many of these doctors have not been included in the hospital's effort to get DSRIP money. This is a federal program that's going to pump millions of dollars into neighborhoods to reduce hospitalization rates, to reduce the time that a patient has to wait at the emergency room. Yet, community doctors have been cut out of this funding that the hospital is proposing to get through the state. So we want to have an independent monitor to make sure that that money is used for proper things and that everybody's included, including the local physicians that have been cut out by the hospital. Who better to have a good relationship with the hospital than primary care physicians in the communities that see patients on a daily basis? And they're many times they don't have the level or the type of communication they should have with the hospital. So we want to see changes there. Mm-hmm. We want to see more privacy. The way the emergency room is right now, you see patients in the hallways on chairs with IVs, right? And there's no privacy. So a woman may go there and have to have a private conversation, a confidential conversation with her doctor in the middle of this chaos. And so that should not be the standard for a hospital that touts to be one of the best in the world. So we want to change these things. We want to change the culture of the hospital, which some time back was more community-oriented, more medical service-oriented, and now is more corporate. It's more profit-oriented. We want to stop that. We want to make sure that they know that there is a community that they service, and we demand better services.
Yeah, everyone should have access to quality health care.
Absolutely so.
And there's more information on your website.
That's correct. We have in my website, not only do we have a copy of the report that we put out that reflects the testimonies that were given during the public hearing and the suggestions and that were given by many people that testify, but we also have the legislation that I've introduced and other issues that are important to the emergency room situation in New York Presbyterian Hospital.
And that's sbiat.nysenate.gov.
That's correct.
Yes. All right. So you are the ranking member of the Housing Committee. What is the most important housing issue facing your district?
Well, there are two, right? One is the creation of affordable housing. And to that end, we have included the Democrats in the Senate. Our conference has put forward a proposal. Well, we want 30,000 new units of affordable housing built. It's going to cost $500 million to do that. The city has committed monies towards that end. We want to make sure that Northern Manhattan gets a fair share of those affordable units. In addition to that, we have also put in the budget adequate funding for NYCHA, the New York City Housing Authority. And we know that these buildings in the New York City Housing Authorities are really dilapidated. They have a structural issue. So we want capital, an infusion of capital dollars to address issues such as pointing of the buildings, the roof work, boiler work, elevator maintenance, intercom system repair. These are the kinds of issues that people that live in NYCHA buildings face on a daily basis. And it would only take It must take an infusion of capital dollars for that to happen. The governor has proposed $25 million. We feel that that's far too short and that, in fact, it should be $400 million to go towards that end for NYCHA repairs, for NYCHA capital work. We met recently with the chairwoman of the New York City Housing Authority. She's very supportive of this initiative, and I hope that both those initiatives for affordable housing and NYCHA will be included in the budget. On the other end, a post-budget debate is the rent stabilization laws that expire in June. Yeah. And those impact 79,000 units of housing in my district. I have the highest number of rent-stabilized apartments in the percentage in the whole entire state. 79,000 families will be impacted by the rent laws. And so I am pushing hard for issues like vacancy decontrol to be eliminated, for major capital improvement laws to be reformed, for the vacancy bonus that is granted to landlords to be eliminated, for the individual apartment improvement laws to be shifted more towards tenants' rights, for all these issues that are very, very important for preferential rent, which impacts senior citizens and others in a dramatic way, to be looked at. We want to make sure that the rent laws, when they're taken up this year, that they, at the end of the day, tenants are in power, and that their benefits, their protections are strengthened. And this is a real test, I may say, the first time, because lots of money was pumped into the last year's election by the real estate industry to keep the majority Republican in the Senate. So we have this cloud of ethical violations in Albany, and what money is doing to erode the confidence of average New Yorkers in state government. And so this will be the first test to see whether money will impose itself again, and that the landlord interest that really pumped millions of dollars into the last election will get their day when the budget is approved and also when the rent regulation laws are renewed. So we feel very strongly that money should not be the driving force, that the debate should be on the merit of the issue, and then tenants' rights must be strengthened.
So let's show our viewers some of the questions that you are asking at a public budget hearing.
Thank you.
All right.
So there is no dedicated line, budget line, in the budget, in the governor's budget, for the TPU.
No, it's grouped with ORA and part of a total ORA resource.
Yeah, it's rent regulation.
And so ORA has been increased by $8 million, right? The budget in the Office of Rent Administration has been increased by $8 million. And so can you say that $8 million will go towards the TPU? Are you, is that your projection?
No, that's not the case because, again, the digital platform that we spoke about, and you and I have spoken about it before, is also a portion of that increase in the ORA budget.
Okay, so in your assessment, if we've gotten back 37,000 new units, what would it take to bring back 100,000, half of what we lost? How much funding would it take for that to occur?
I'm not sure that we'd be able to figure that out. I don't know that that's knowable.
Okay, and let's go now to the other tool that I think that we have within your agency to try to maintain and recapture those units that working families and middle-class families have lost in the city of New York, which is the Office of Rent Administration. And as my colleague, the chairwoman of the Housing Committee stated, the controller just put out a report highlighting the delays that tenants have to wait, time they have to wait to get an answer from such a unit. What is the current funding for that unit right now? Is it $38,000, $38 million?
For the
Office of Rent Administration.
We'll get you that information.
Well, let me just go through some numbers that I have, and perhaps this could shed some light. In the year 2010 to 2011, the office was funded at $42 million. 11-12, $37 million. And since then, it's been consistent at 38. And so we know that with this level of funding, according to the state, New York State Controller, you know, the actual wait time that tenants have to struggle through is unacceptable.
So safe, affordable rent regulations.
That's correct. That was in the middle of a hearing with the commissioner of the housing agency for the state, and we were talking about the tenant protection unit, the TPU, which very often defends tenants in court against unscrupulous landlords. In my district, we saw several cases where they stepped in and they took to court these landlords that were abusing tenants' rights, and they were actually able to hit them in the pocket where it hurts. And so they're a very effective unit, but they don't get the funding that they should get to really do more. And there's no dedicated budget line for them in the New York State budget. We're trying to get a dedicated funding stream for them permanently so that every year they don't have to come and fight for $5 or $4 million for this particular unit within the housing agency.
And you have legislation to help with civil lawsuits, right?
That's correct. We want to make sure that just like you have in criminal court where somebody goes in and they have access to legal aid, that you will get the legal services that you deserve when you go to landlord-tenant court. And what happens very often is that most tenants go to landlord-tenant court without an attorney. And so they're fighting with one hand tied behind their back. And the landlords, of course, have these very high-end, very expensive attorneys representing their interests in landlord-tenant court. And we all know then the end of that story, right, which is often that tenants enter into an agreement that they cannot keep. They wind up in court again months later and eventually facing potential eviction.
Right. So the rent regulation laws that expire in June, you have a petition on your website, so anyone could join you.
That's correct.
To make sure.
Go to our website and sign the petition. It's important that we hear from you that the governor hears from you, that the leadership, the Republican leadership in the state Senate also hear from you.
All right. Thank you so much for being with
us,
Senator.
Thank you for inviting me once again.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Adriano Espaillat. For additional information on health care and housing and to follow the budget process, espaillat.nysenate.gov.